சுபாஷினி மேம்,
மேம் ஸ்டார்ட் பண்ணிடலாமா மேம்?
ஸ்டார்ட் பண்ணலாம்ப்பா.
ஓகே ஓகே மேம், தேங்க் யூ.
லோகேஷன் ஜாயின் பண்ணியாச்சா?
லோகேஷன் வந்தாச்சு. அப்படி லோகேஷ்வர், லோகேஷ்வர் 10 minutes back நேம் பார்த்தேன். ஆக்சுவலா பூர்வஜித், பூர்வஜித்
ஜாயின் பண்ணிட்டாரு மேம். அவர் ஜாயின்
பண்ணிட்டாங்க, அப்பவே ஜாயின் பண்ணிட்டாங்க. லோகேஷ்வர்
மேம், மேம் சொல்லுங்க மேம்.
ஓகே ஓகே, குட் மார்னிங் லோகேஷ்வர். ஓகே, ஷல் வி ஸ்டார்ட் மா?
யா, ஸ்டார்ட் மா.
ஓகே, குட் மார்னிங் எவ்ரிவன்.
லோகேஷ்வர், லோகேஷ்வர், ஆர் யூ ஹியர்?
ஹலோ ஹலோ
ஹலோ.
குட் மார்னிங் மேம்.
வாசன்ட்
ஐ ஆடிபிள் பிஃபோர் மேம்? நான் லேப்டாப்ல கனெக்ட்
பண்ணியிருந்தேன். இட்ஸ் ஆடிபிள் ஒன்லி.
ஓகே, இப்போதான் கேக்குது. லைக் ஐ வாஸ் டாக்கிங் ஃபார் தி பாஸ்ட் 5 minutes. ஐ வாஸ் விஷிங் யூ, பட் ஓகே இட்ஸ் ஃபைன். ஐ திங்க் நவ் ஐ கனெக்டட் த்ரூ மொபைல் அண்ட் ஐ எம் ஏபிள் டு, ஐ மீன் யூ கைஸ் ஆர் ஏபிள் டு ஹியர் மீ. ஸோ வி கேன் கெட் ஸ்டார்டட் ரைட் மேம்?
யா யா.
Thank you.
Good morning, everybody, those who are connected here. I hope that you are all safe and healthy now. Okay, I'm happy to introduce Lokeshwar here because he is the today's resource person. He followed his yesterday's session today also. I'm not able to join yesterday. Lokeshwar is one of our elite alumni. He is working in Verizon. Very few students are still connected with the department and close to my heart. Lokeshwar is one among them. I thank the Purajit for arranging such a wonderful workshop through CLUG. Lokeshwar, I appreciate your interest towards your working passion, because CLUG is a, what is this, Lokeshwar? You are not in a St. Joseph dress code and all. Okay,
ma,
show your face.
Yes, ma'am. It's because of the quarantine. The salons are closed and I'm not able to cut my hair.
Still, you are connected with the CLUG, isn't it?
Yes, ma'am. Of course. It's my pleasure.
Very
that
few are, along with their career, they are working with their passion also. Thanks for conducting such a wonderful workshop for our CLUG students. What about your blockchain research activities?
Currently, I am in the full stack development mode, ma'am. I have suspended those blockchain activities, but maybe after a couple of years, I may resume it based on my career path. But
because
yes, thank you for that.
It's in the recent trends, no?
Yes, yes.
Yourself true. And Syed started very earlier itself, in your third year, I think so.
Yes.
Okay, ma'am. Okay. What about your
hand
studies and all?
It's under
progress. No, you applied some university. No.
No, I am currently preparing for IELTS, ma'am.
Oh yes. Okay. All the best. My hearty wishes for your future endeavors.
Thank
for
you.
Conducting such a wonderful workshop.
Okay, thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you for the opportunity. Yes.
You can continue.
Yeah. So yes, very good morning, guys. Thanks a lot for your feedback that I received yesterday. It was so good, and I was able to go through it and based on that, I have made a couple of changes for today's session. So one thing is I will be changing the language. So yesterday I had a mixture of Tamil and English, but I saw that in the feedback there were like 4 to 5 students from Maharashtra, Karnataka and Andhra. So apologies for them, I didn't know that. So today it will be a full English session. And the second thing is, yesterday we had a lot of theory, but a little of hands-on. But today it's going to be 20% theory and 80% of hands-on. So that's how today's session is planned. Even if you don't, it's not like that, but I require your full attention when the hands-on part is getting standard, it's getting started, because I have planned to make a full-fledged application which involves all the data handling, request response and forms kind of stuff. So it's going to be a little more fast paced when compared to yesterday. So that's it. Let's get started. I will start to share my screen. Just tell me when you're able to see the screen, or even you can ping in the chat box. My laptop is kind of stuck. Just give me a minute. Hello, is anyone able to view my screen? Okay. Can anyone answer through audio? I'm not able to see the chat box. It's my laptop is kind of stuck.
Location and I still not visible.
Okay. I don't know. For some reason, my laptop is stuck. I guess I need to restart. So it will take 5 minutes. Until that time, I will communicate through my audio alone.
Okay.
So, yes. So anyway, before we start, let me first restart this. Okay, it's getting restarted. So before it gets restarted, I would like to communicate something to all the participants who are in like a second and third year stage. So I want to tell a small kutty story of mine when I was in my second years. So there was a conference called hello.
Purushita, I'm audible, right?
Yeah, you are audible.
Yeah, okay, thank you. So there was a conference called 4CCon that was conducted by FSFTN along with their sponsorship and organizing support. So it was a 4 days workshop that happened in Abdul Rahman University in near Perungalathur, I guess. So it was at that conference that I attended a React workshop conducted by Mr. Vaishak. I still have contact with him. He is also a resource person from FSFTN, an open source contributor, and I would like to mention him here because it was because of his kickstart or the initiative, I got the more interest on web development and especially React.js framework. So what I would like to just give me a second. So what I would like to tell you guys is there are a lot of things apart from the books and the syllabus that we are going through, and there are a lot of technologies and lot of frameworks getting developed. Like, you know, every 2 years, not even 2 years, a lot of technologies are booming in the industry, and the industry expects us to adapt and update ourselves based on the new technologies, and we need to do that in early stage itself. So being a second year or third year student is the right a point of time where you can initiate yourself and make use of these other extracurricular organizations other than your college, like say FSFTN, and we have many other community clubs. I am more into FSFTN because it has helped me a lot since my second year. So not only FSFTN, every week if you go and visit meetup.com, we have a lot of meetups that are going there. Like, we have some IoT Chennai community, Mozilla Firefox community, and Chennai School of AI, and all these communities like conduct like two times or one time in once in a month workshops that would take around just 100 to 200 bucks per person. Maybe now it might go 300 agriklam. So in that way, try to go and attend those things, and you'll get a lot of exposure through those community. You will get networking with people, know about, and you will get a clear idea on where you should start after finishing your college. So this was something I was about to tell before starting the session, and unfortunately my laptop got struck and it's getting restarted. I guess I have joined again. Let me share my screen now. And after joining the organization, I had very little time to contribute back to FSFTN because, you know, I have taken a lot from the community, but it's very little that I have given back. And this is a good opportunity for me to give back to the society. And thanks for FSFTN Glug and the college to providing this opportunity. My tabs are closed. Let me restore. I guess now you are able to see the screen. Purujit, are you able to see the screen?
Yes,
yeah, it's visible. Yeah.
Yes, thank you. Okay, that was a small technical glitch. That's why we were able to. Sorry for the delay. Okay, fine. Let's get started before it's too late. And so we stopped here. What are the components and the types of components? Stateless functional components and stateful class component. But we will be mostly using stateful class component because it has the power of managing a state and also receiving the props and a lot of lifecycle methods that would help a lot in industry when you work in industry. And you know, believe me, most of the bugs that I have encountered till now are resolved through the lifecycle methods. And you might not understand the power of lifecycle methods when we work on a simple application, but when you work on a large scale application, when you handle a lot of data, those lifecycle methods will be so useful. So this was the event that I was telling about, ForeseeCon, that happened in 2017 January. That was a memorable event and was a game changer in my life. And I just wanted to suggest you all guys to explore more than your college curriculum. and participate in other community activities and conferences to explore a lot. Okay. So yeah, this is what I'm gonna start with, the component life cycle. So for each and every class-based component, when it gets executed or when it gets rendered, there are these three stages that is going to happen. One is before the component gets mounted or initialized or updated. So mounted means it is the first time it's getting created and getting attached to the DOM. So we I guess you remember what is a DOM and what is the virtual DOM or everything that we discussed yesterday. So initialization is the stage that happens before is the first it happens for the one time once alone before it gets mounted. So the number of functions that we have is get initial state, get default props, component will mount, render, and component did mount. So all these happens once before it gets mounted. Then we have this update stage. So the lifecycle methods that we have in this update stage is going to happen every time the component gets updated. So I have a component mounted, but after some time when the data is getting changed, the state of the component gets changed, right? So yesterday we saw a counter application. So there was a state called counter. So counter was 0. When I clicked the button, it got increased to 1. When I clicked the button again, it got increased to 2. So that is the state change, and that's where the component needs to get updated. So during each and every updation of a component, these are the lifecycle methods that we that's going to happen in the background. That's going to happen in background, and we will see its uses in short in the next in few minutes. The next one is the destruction stage. So if there is any component that we are not going to show or that we are going to unmount during the website. So say that you are logging into a website. So yesterday we had an IRCTC website. So when we log into the website, the login page will come. So after logging in, the login page disappears, right? So in React's language, it is called unmounting a component. So we unmount the login component and we mount the profile page component. So that's how it happens in the background. During that happens, there are a certain number of steps that need to be carried on when a component gets unmounted. Say we would need to cut the memory, like we might need to demolish the memory, or we don't really manage memory stuff, but something like session management or cutting the display of the component. So such few things will happen in this component will unmount lifecycle. So to know more about this lifecycle, the best place is this one, W3 Schools React Lifecycle. So you can just search for in Google, like React Lifecycle W3 Schools. I thought of making this into slides, but I thought maybe it would be great to show you the source itself, so this is one place where you get the clear cut, a simple understanding of what are the React lifecycle methods. So so yesterday we discussed about the constructor. So that is one of the lifecycle method that happens during the initialization stage. And there is this get derived state from props. So this is a lifecycle method where you get the props from the parent component and assign it to the state of the current component. So yesterday we had an example where we had a button in the child component and parent component with, I guess, I don't remember the name, something like counter page 2, I guess. Yeah, counter page 2. So when I pass the props from the counter page 2, the props went into the button and I used that props. But suppose if I want to maintain that props as a state in the button, then I will use this lifecycle method to maintain those things. And one more thing, guys, it's not necessary that we must use this lifecycle methods but it's kind of better, and it's industry recommended practice to use life cycle methods so that it becomes more readable and more manageable and also more debuggable. So these three things are very important when you develop an application in an industry: readable, manageable, and what was the third thing? Debuggable. So and debuggable is very important, because you may write something and go somewhere, and when another person comes in and looks at your code, he should not scold you, right? So that is something you have to keep in mind. So usage of life. So I'm just telling about the importance of using lifecycle. So this, we have this render method, and if you see in this slide, you have the render method in the initialization stage and also in update stage. So remember, for the first time when you mount a component, two times it gets rendered, one time for initialization and another for update also. So every time you update, the render again happens. Obviously, it has to happen again, right? And render is the only lifecycle method that must be implemented. All other lifecycle methods can or cannot be implemented. You can use in any other ways, but render is a must, but others are may. You may or you may not, but recommended to be used. So yes, and other, we have component did mount. So component did mount is something that we want to do after the component gets mounted. I don't want to go deep into all the lifecycle methods because we have a lot to catch up. And it's already 11:21. Wow. Okay. So the next, in the updating, we have get derived state from props. So this is a method where we get the props and assign the state during the update stage. And should component update is an interesting lifecycle method to increase the performance of your React component. So say there is something you are changing within your component, but that doesn't need the component to be updated. Say there is some data that you are changing, but at that point of time, you don't want it to be updated. So what you can do is you can mention in the, you can mention in this lifecycle method that if this happens, I don't want to update this component. So the scenario for this, if I start, it would take a long time. So just understand the use. So this lifecycle method returns a Boolean value, whether a true or false. If you want to update, you will say you will return true. If you don't want to update, you will just say you return false. So that's what is mentioned here. You can give a read, go through after this session. You will really get a good understanding because it's given in simple English with lot of good examples. And get snapshot before update. I haven't used this that much, but it claims to say that we can get a copy or a state of the component before the update. And we have component did update. This we kind of use a lot of times. Just have a go through it. And I already explained you about the component will unmount, where you do stuff when before you unmounting a component. So this is something important. Even when you write an exam on React or attend an interview on React, I bet you will definitely have questions from the lifecycle of React, because this is something that we use regularly in industry. So yeah. So let's switch to the next slide. Yeah, data flow and event flow. This is supposed to be, I should have told this yesterday itself, but it's not too late than ever. So one main principle that you need to understand in React is data always flows from top to bottom. That is, you always get the data from the parent component to the child component, and you never ever send the data from the child component to the parent component. Remember this, data flow is always from top to bottom, from the parent component to the child component, and you never ever pass any data from the child component to the parent component. There are obvious reasons behind this, but you will understand, rather than me telling, you will understand when you do with your own experience. You will get it, but just remember this point. And the second point is the events. So event flow is always from bottom to up. So yesterday we had one example. So the button click. So we had that event in the child component, but we had executed the function in the parent component. So that's a perfect example for to say that event flow is from the child component to the parent component. So I have an event in the child. When I trigger it, it triggers from the child, but it executes the function in the parent component. So that's how it happens. You may even have events in the, I mean, within a component, but you can't have an event from a parent component to the child component. So that's what I am trying to mention here. Yeah, this is kind of a simply put slide to a summary of what I have explained. So data flows down. Props is immutable. This is very important. So whenever we pass a props, you can't change it. You can only assign it to your state and change according to your wish, but you can never ever mutate the props, which means, or mutate means change. So you can, you should not modify the props that you receive. So it's like a property that you receive from your parents, and you have to keep it safe and make sure you don't, handle it in a not. So yeah, I think you get it. So if you want to do something, have your own state, have your own variables, and assign those props to that state and do whatever you want. And anything can be passed to children as props, states, handlers, and styles. I think yesterday I had a question and I think I understood in a wrong manner. I think someone asked if we can pass components itself as props to another component. No, that won't happen. You can only pass the handlers, styles, props, and states. You cannot pass components to your child components as props. So that is what I wanted to tell. And event flows up, I told you, through parent passed handler props. So I guess we are fine with this. Okay. So before I show the slide, I want to show you something else. And as my system got restarted, I got to start those things again. So there'll be a kind of 2 minutes gap. Just take, just give me 2 minutes. I will make the setup ready. Where do I have my stuff? Meanwhile, if you have any questions or comments, you can just turn your audio on and ask me stuff. So this is an application called Repo Finder React. This is a web React application that I developed in mid-2019, I guess, before joining the organization. So I kind of wanted a full-fledged React app that has all the things in it. So fortunately, I developed in that time, and it is kind of, it will be useful now. You will get to know it. My system kind of little slow in opening the terminal. Just hold on to that. Okay, we have it. And what am I going to do is start this application. I hope you are able to. Okay, I'm not inside the application. lscd repo. Oh, you're not seeing the terminal. Okay, I forgot to share my whole screen. It's now only I recognized. Now, are you able to see my screen? Can anyone answer? My entire screen? Are you able to see my terminal now? Is anyone in the chat replying? Okay, I got answers. Thank you. Yes, thank you so much. So yes, I was just trying to start my previously developed React application. So this repo finder React is a web application that helps you to show repositories from GitHub based on the language. So suppose I give an input like Java or Ruby or something else like C. So it will, there is an API in GitHub that returns the list of repositories based on the language and based on the number of forks and number of stars that it has. You will understand when I show you the, you know, the API. Okay, I think I have it already. Let me show you. Yes, I have it. Is my screen readable? Okay, I will increase the size. I guess you are able to see. So this is the the above link is an API. So for people who don't know what API is, I guess you remember yesterday when I showed a slide in the very beginning. This one. So you remember this slide? So I told a web app gives a request to the server, and the server fetches some data from the database, all the file server. At this point, let's keep just the database. So the server gets some data based on the request from the database and gives back the response to the web app. And it's our duty, it's the front-end developer's duty to extract the needed information from the received data and show what is required. So now what we are going to do is we are going to send a request to the GitHub server. So GitHub provides this facility to send data based on few APIs. So there is a separate API documentary where you can see what all the requests that we can send to that server. So one such request is, let me just finish this. So when the server gives the response to the web app, it can be in kind of any format like HTML, JSON, XML, and what else? Okay, these are the three most popular things as I know as of now. Today we are gonna handle a JSON response from the GitHub server's API, and see how we can parse it and extract the data from it and also display it. Okay, 11:30. Nice. So this is the API. This is the link. So this is the request. What I'm doing is I'm hitting the, okay, I will show it in Chrome. Yeah, so this is the API and I'm hitting the GitHub server, and in return, I am getting a raw data. So this is the raw data, a lot of stuff. So all these data will, JSON is a response data where you have a key value pair stuff. So this is a key and this is the value. So key, value, pair. And when it starts with the curly braces, it means it returns an object, and inside this big whole object, okay, let's make this JSON raw data readable. So in that big whole object, we have three value pairs. One is the total count, the other one is the incomplete results, the other one is the items. So total count is the repositories that we have, and this has returned seven, okay, I don't know whether it's in lakhs or thousands, okay, just leave that aside. But we have filtered in such a way that in one page I get only 30 repositories at once, okay. So the items that we have is 30. It starts from 0 to 30. So each item has information about a repository, and what information it has is it has its ID, node ID, owner, description, folks URL, keys URL, collaborators, a lot of stuff. So all these data are returned in a JSON format, and what we are going to do is we are going to fetch some of these data and display. So I guess you remember we started an application, and let's see that application. So this is the application. I know it's kind of simple right now because I didn't select any language. So here is a simple select a drop down box. So in this, I'm going to select a language, say Java. And yeah, so here is it. So when I selected Java, it returns a list of repositories which are the most famous repositories in Java language. So based on the forks, actually. So this is kind of fork is something in GitHub where you how to say, okay, let's just leave aside that concept. Forks is some, just say that a popularity of a repository can be determined with the number of forks in GitHub. GitHub users might know this very well, but I don't want to divert and explain about it. So let's keep simple. We just receive a list of repositories and we can display the repositories in this format. So today's objective is to develop the exact very same application from scratch. And we will see if time permits, because I took like 5 hours to create this application. But we will try to build this in 1 hour. But in a minimalistic format, but without a lot of designs and without a lot of details, we will kind of develop a very simple minimalistic application which looks like this itself. So let's get started. So this is the folder that I have for you guys. I am opening the terminal. And so I guess you remember the command to create a new React app, create hyphen React hyphen app space, give me a React name. So I will just give a similar name, something like git repo finder. Enter and let this get created. Meanwhile, I will see if we have some questions. Do we? Okay, nice. No questions. If you get any questions at this point of time, you can give in the chat box. And yesterday, a person asked a good question that if we can use Yarn, Yarn to install React. Yes, you can. Recommended as NPM, but you can always do from Yarn also. There is one more thing I wanted to convey to you guys. There was something that happened yesterday, right? We got an error. So at that point of time, I was not able to debug. So later I found out that I entered those thing in the different file. If you remember, the file that we edited is app.js. And when we edit a component, we should return something, but yesterday I didn't return anything, and that's why it was giving an error. It's supposed to be entered in index.js rather than app.js. My bad. So yeah, that happens sometimes. That might happen today also. If that happens, we will get into our original app and I will try to explain. No problem. No worries. Oh God. I'm kind of out of power. Let me shift to another place. I'm sorry, guys. My laptop got switched off. I need to restart again. There was a power failure and I didn't notice. I have moved to another place, so I will need another 5 more minutes to get it restarted. Apologies for that. Meanwhile, I can have some questions from you guys and I can answer through audio. Purajit, just see through the chat, and if you receive any questions, just can you pass it over to me through audio? Hello. Yes, Nelson, we are using Visual Studio Code. That will be easy for React development because it has a lot of extensions inbuilt inside the Visual Studio Code, and it's an open source, so a lot of people can contribute through by to the Visual Studio Code by writing extensions. So it's a very great editor to develop web frameworks like React and Angular, etc. Anyone have any other questions? I can answer till my laptop gets restarted.
Yeah, students, if you have queries, you can unmute and then ask.
Yes. Was I so clear and understandable that no one has any questions?
There are two categories. They know everything, as if they know everything. Students, please respond. Only then the session will be interactive.
If this was an in-person session, then I would have taken this very, very much interactive. This is my second online session, so maybe I...
No, Logeshwar, it's nice. No issues in this.
Okay, thank you for the feedback.
Will it take more time for you?
Hello, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, it will take some time for you?
No. I have opened the Chrome. I just have to log in and share my screen.
Okay.
That's why instead of having the question and answer session, that's why I was asking for questions.
Yeah, if you have any questions, you can ask now. Separate session will not be allotted.
It is not necessary that it should be related to React. It can be related to your placement preparation and future scope and a lot of things.
About higher studies.
Higher studies, I don't know much, but yes, I will tell what I can.
No, you are right now. You are preparing for that, right? so you can give some predictions.
Not much, maybe. Okay. Just tell me when you are able to see my screen. I guess you are able to.
Yeah, accessible.
Okay. Yes, thank you. Thank you so much for responding. Yeah, I need to start the application again. So let me get this started.
Dear students, feedback link will be provided at the end. And after that, you will be getting certificates within 3 days.
I have to create that React app again because previously it stopped abruptly, right? So let me give another name. I am out of names right now. Okay. Something like repository. Filter app. It is kind of big, but it's okay. Meanwhile, it gets created. I will show you something else. So having the React framework, we have a lot of external libraries and ready-made components available from the website. A very good example for that kind of thing is React Bootstrap. So the link is reactbootstrap.github.io. So this is also an open source library that has ready-made components. So as you can see here, there are a lot of examples like this. So this is one of the a pop-up kind of thing. There are like accordion, badges, buttons. So if you see these buttons, these are like ready-made. You just have to import the library and use this tag. So this is a component, and by mentioning this component and passing this props like a variant, you will get this button in your website. So it's so this is the power of components that I was talking about to you yesterday. So to create a button like this through vanilla JS means not vanilla JS, like plain JS and plain HTML, you need to do a lot of things. Like you see in the corner, there's some rounded closure. And when you hover over it, there is some highlighting. The color, the primary thing is kind of centered within the button. So all these CSS and JS attributes are inbuilt into the component, and we just need to import and use that. That's all. You will get it. Not only the button, we have a lot of things. We have a small button, link button, see block level button. All these things, you just need to pick the line, pick the appropriate lines from this website, import the library and just fix it. That's all. You will get that done. And there are like so many other things like drop downs. You see these kind of drop downs. And let me show, nav bar. So see, this kind of nav bar is difficult to design when you or write through plain JavaScript. So you just have to enter this code in your file and import the library, and you will get this. and you can further customize this based on your necessities. So this is the power of components I was telling you about yesterday, and we will be using a couple of components like this in today's our web application also. With the time, I don't know, we have already lost like 15 minutes. Let's see if we can cope up with stuff. And this is getting installed again. I think I should have already created, but it's fine. Okay, it's still getting installed. Let this happen. So there are like three libraries that I know. So one is React Bootstrap, and there is another thing called React Select, which we will be using it today. So React Select is something like you can have a drop down with a more customized options and handling those event changes. It will be easy for us to use this. And we have MD Bootstrap, that is another good library. Let me show you. And one more thing is, all these components are bootstrapped. When I say bootstrap, it means it gets, you know, the components gets adjusted to the size of the window. So if you see the size of these the components doesn't get disrupted at all. It automatically changes to the mobile view when you kind of decrease the size, and you can also increase based on it. And there is an extension that we have in Chrome. Let me show you. Okay, let's not divert, but this is one another website with lot of good components. And this is not completely open source, because there are some components for price, some very well developed matured components will come along with a price, and we might have to pay, but you won't need it. There are a lot of things in the free version itself. Let me show. Yeah. The components I have, like cards, we will be using cards today. So a card is something like this. You have a title like thing with a picture, a title with an example, I mean with a description and a button. So all we have to do is just copy this piece of code and the library and use it on in our files, and this appears. You just have to modify the image URL and the description to make that possible. So let's see if this, yeah, okay, super. Now let's get started. So as I told yesterday, we can open this in our Visual Studio Code. Let me make this bigger code, or my laptop kind of got crazy today. I don't know why. Maybe it's because it's on for more than 24 hours. Apologies to my laptop. I will shut down immediately after the session got over. Okay, we got this. So what we have here is not necessary. Yeah. The repo finder reactor. Did I? Okay, I opened a different directory. Okay, amazing. So I think you remember yesterday we had package.json explode. By default, we have React, React DOM and React scripts. But today we will be installing another two more libraries called React Bootstrap and React Select. You will get to know about that soon. And now let's start with the app.js. So yesterday we had this, and you remember the homepage, right? Having a big React logo rotating. So that is what this code. And we are gonna just simply remove this stuff. And what am I gonna do is, so for our application that we are gonna develop right now, it has a specific structure, and I'm gonna explain that structure right to you now. So, yeah, so this is the structure that I wanted to explain to you. So we will be having an app component. Currently we are in the app component. Inside that we will be having one component called the body component. Inside that we will have three components, select, display result, and inside the display result, okay, I should have drawn a box on this. So inside the body content, we will have select and display result. Inside the display result, we will have card template, and inside the card template, we will have the cards that we have. Just now I showed you a tile kind of card, right? So that will be displayed in a repetitive looped manner to have a good visual. So let's get started. So first we need to create this body content component. So where is it? Yeah, so I'm gonna return body. Come on. So I'm gonna return a body content component, but I haven't created a body content component yet. So what I'm gonna do is I'm just gonna create a new file saying bodycontent.js. And I need a template kind of thing. Let me just find that really quick. Yeah. So just to avoid time constraints, I had a template kind of, okay, I think I deleted it. Nice. Repo. Okay, let's get started. So I told you yesterday, right? We don't need to like remember all the syntax and stuff. We can always get the help of a web, and we will have the appropriate content there. You just need to get the right content and just have that displayed. So I have, I need to import, let me get it from here. So the name of the component should be the body content. So body content extends the React component. We are having the constructor which gets the props from the thing. We don't need this state. Let me just take this. And by default, we need a state called isLoaded, which is defaultly false. you will get to know the reason behind this. And here I would like to say the title of this thing, repository filter app, right? Repository filter app. And we need to export without forgetting. Export default. And okay, I need to tell something here. If you see here, the body content is kind of not so highlighted. So it says it is declared but never used. Definitely it will never get be used unless it gets exported. So we have to mention at the end, export default body content. So just understand the each and every line that you use when you develop a program. Understand, until you don't understand the reason behind what you're doing, you won't be able to develop a proper application. And let me save these stuff and let us see if this is working. Where is my... I'm going to start this app, npm start. Okay, it's already running. Nice. I'm sorry, I forgot. No, it isn't running. It is the other app that is running. I just want my stuff to be displayed in Chrome browser because, okay, body content is, I guess I am making the mistake again. Let me see. So what does the error say? Body content is not defined. Oh, did I import that? Oh, wow. Okay. In app.js, I didn't import the body content. Yes. So this is how you debug. So see, here it says in app.js line number 7, body content is not defined. So in a rush, I forgot to import the stuff. So here in app.js in line number 7. So previously it was in line number 7. The body content is mentioned, but the React app doesn't know where this body content came from. So what I need to do is I need to import body content from here. So what you're going to do is space. You need to mention the directory location. So dot refers the current location, and slash will tell what are the files listed in that current location. So you have app.test, body content, index, and service worker, etc. But you need the body content. So after this, if I save and look at this, see, we got the application. So this is our first thing. But now what we're going to try is, I don't like this, title at all. I need a good, sophisticated kind of design title. So I'm gonna get the help from the React Bootstrap that I showed you. So we have this badges. So badges is something that you see. So it will show like this with something like highlighted stuff. I just wanted to use this component, so I am trying to demonstrate this. But before using this component, we need to install this library, right? So let us see how to install this library. So when you see into the get started option, you will see the command npm install React Bootstrap Bootstrap. So I'm just need to execute this command to get that library imported. But before doing that, I need to show you something. So in our application, if you see the package.json, we have only React, React DOM, and React scripts. But after installing, we will get the React Bootstrap dependency mentioned here also. So let me install that. So yeah, so this is the repository filter app. So the command that I copied is pasted here, npm install React Bootstrap Bootstrap. Let it get installed. This will be quick because it's just one library, I guess so. Apologies for the fuss happened all over because of the my laptop restarted twice. So all my predefined setup got closed and I'm kind of, you know, rushed as the time is getting delayed. So that's why the confusions that you are getting. So yes, it's got restarted, and you see here, this I didn't mention at all. The Bootstrap and React Bootstrap, when I did that command, it automatically got included in the package.json, which says there is a dependency and you have. And so VS Code has this amazing feature that says which line is new from the previous file, like what is modified in your current file. So if you see this green line, this represents that this new line is added in this file. If I change another line, say add a comma, it will say it will bring a blue line which says that it is modified. So if I click on this green line, you can see the two changes, saying that previously this wasn't there, but after installing these, we got these two lines. So I hope you understand and get the beauty of the VS Code editor. Yeah. So let's get mode. We have to just save this app.js. So inside the body content, I need to use the badge, right? So before that, I need to import this. The React Bootstrap library into my JS file. So you can see that, it's mentioned here. The following line can be included in your source/index.js or app.js file so that it gets imported. So I need to import this library or copy this file and paste it in my index.js. So done. I have added a new line. I have saved it. Now, the components. I need the badge component, right? So, to include this badge component, I am going to use this line. Copy. Inside the body content, I am going to replace it with this. So, there is a badge component I have used here. But remember, if I run this, it will throw an error or scold me saying you haven't told where the badge came from. So without forgetting, again, we need to import badge from this is so as the we have imported the library, we can access the library directly. So the name of the library is React Bootstrap. See, VS Code recognizes the dependencies and it is showing me the library in my suggestions. So just click on it, and when you click a slash, and you can just import that badge, and you can see that badge is in there, is there directly. So just mention that, save it, and I guess I have stopped the application again. So let me start it. So see, we got that example heading new. So in our thing, we just have to change this into repository filter app, and this variant secondary really is not so good for me. So I'm going to change it into, let's see what we need to change. So we have secondary as variant, we have primary, success, danger, warning, light. So I kind of like success. So I'm just, what I'm going to do is I'm just going to copy this success. I know I can just type it out, but just kidding. So instead of secondary, I'm going to paste success and save it. And you can see in our React app, repository, filter app, see, in within a word, you have changed the background, you have changed the appearance and all. So our work has reduced. Now the second thing, if you remember, we have discussed to include the select component and display result inside the body content. So let me go into the body content, and I'm gonna, okay, one more thing is the indentation. When you work in an organization, make sure you write your code which is in a proper indented manner, because you know, when you're it looks nice when it is in this way, otherwise people who read it further will find it very difficult to understand where it is opening and where the tag is closing and all. So I just wanted to mention that. So now we are going to have a select. Select tag, and this select tag is also a component from another library which I mentioned earlier, which is the React select library. So a person asked yesterday if we can use Yarn. So here is your example. You can use Yarn, add, React, select to use it. So I'm just gonna copy it. I'm gonna stop again, paste it. Okay, let me try. I guess I don't have Yarn. Okay, we have it in npm itself, so let's just try with that. Okay, we got it. And if you see the package.json again, you see React select is added. You didn't do anything, you just gave a one line comment, and you are able to see that in our dependency. And so import the default export and render in your component. So import select from React select. I will go to body content, enter this, import select from React select. I have the select, and currently I don't have anything in that select, so let it be. I will explain. And if you see here, there is an error that is throwing, and says JS expressions must have only one parent element. So it's because I am returning two elements inside this return, and that shouldn't happen. I told you yesterday that everything should be returned under a single parent tag. So let me enclose this inside a div. Cut, paste, save, and start. So see, we have got the drop down, but we don't have any options at all. And you know, in our without using the component, we can't get this. I mean, in a plain HTML, we don't get this blue outline, and we don't get this placeholder saying select. And if we don't have any options, we don't get this no options under the thing. So all these things are pre-built inside the select component, and you can also you also have the liberty to view at the component. So this is the predefined select component that we have. So see how much code is given inside the select component to make that reusable. So this is the power of components and the power of libraries that React provides, and let's just make use of it. So now I need to give a list of options here. So see, So if you see here, inside the select component, I am passing the options, and that options should be a list of items. I mean, an array of items. So what I'm gonna do is I'm just gonna copy this options, copy. And I'm gonna paste here, and I don't want to use const. So the value I'm gonna give is Java, and here Java, because the API has the language. I will explain. In the API, you need to pass a language string saying which language you need to a query on. So this is the list of items in the options array, and we are going to pass this options inside the select. So so this is like passing this data as props into the select component from the parent component. So body content is the parent component. I have this data called options, and what am I going to do is I'm going to pass this data as props to the select component. And the name of the props that I'm going to give is options, because by default select accepts the props option to populate the drop-down items, and it suggests the options to use. So I'm going to use options equal to, I'm going to use a JSX expression. So inside the curly braces, so I mentioned yesterday that any JS expression that you need to use should be within the curly braces, and inside this curly braces you can use this dot options. So see body content dot options in the, you can see in the suggestions itself. When you click enter, that's what gets referred. So this options is used and passed as props to the select option. Now if I give save and press enter, see you have got the drop down, and when I click on the drop down you see Java and Ruby. It's so simple as such. So now what we have done is we have created a body component. We have a drop down inside the body component. with languages. But what we need to have is, when I select an option, either Java or Ruby, I need to execute a function to call the GitHub API and get the result. So we need to write a function that calls the GitHub API and get results. And the last one we need to do is call the function when an option is changed in the dropdown. So this is what we are going to do. We already created a body component and we have a dropdown inside it. Now we have to do the third and fourth step. So now I'm going to write a function that does all this stuff of getting the response from the URL and populating it. So the function name is update language equal to function. So this is the function, and this is an arrow function. It's very similar to the function, but it has a lot of additional properties like returning and getting the values. It's the ES6 syntax. You just have a search on it in Google.
Sorry to disturb you, Logeshwar.
Yes, ma'am.
I'm not able to view your presentation.
Oh, is it so? I was... Okay. Is anyone else facing the same problem?
Anybody is having this issue?
Okay, I will see in the chat box if anyone else is facing the issue.
Maybe actually I got disconnected and then I reconnected it. Maybe due to that it's an issue or no? I don't know.
Yes, maybe, ma'am. Because I could see that few people have replied that they are able to see the screen.
Okay, fine.
Okay, ma'am. Okay, we have a question from Nelson. So if we depend on third party, do we get any issues in future if we want any change in our app? Okay, this is a good, really good question. Yes, having dependencies might affect, but here what you are doing is you are downloading the whole library and keeping it in our environment and using that library to render those components. So this is kind of, we are accessing it in a static way. We are not accessing this a component from a CDN or from online dynamically. We are downloading the library and having this in our client side, and we are accessing the components from that library and reusing it. So unless and until we keep our hands on the downloaded library, we won't have any problem. But maybe in the future, if we have any deprecated things or we need to update, or kind of we might need to update, and if we don't get a support from them, yeah, that might cause a problem.
Hi.
Hello. Yes. So you have any questions? Okay, fine. I guess it was a okay, no problem. So let's return back to our state. So we were in the third step in writing a function that calls the GitHub API and gets the results. So let me define the git URL. So git URL equal to, and I had that URL here, right? So this is the URL. But a small change that we need in the URL is, can everyone go on mute, please? I am hearing an echo of my own voice. Yes, I guess now it's good. So a small change we need in the URL is, this is a static URL. And in this URL, you can see in the parameters that in the language, it is specified Java. But we need to change this language. We need to give either Java or Ruby or C or something else. So I'm going to replace this string, and instead of Java, I'm going to replace this with a variable. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to mention this dot, I will be getting the language through this function. So I will pass a lang string, and this lang string I will be using it here. So I am appending the lang string. So what happens is when you call this function, you will call along with the lang string. I mean, you will pass the lang string to this function, and this language string will be used here. So suppose if I pass Java, this function captures the string Java, and this will gets appended to this link, and we will find the link that is, when we call this API, that corresponding parsed language string will be appended in the API. So that's how we do it. So the next thing that we need to do is fetch, we have to hit a request from our side, right? So fetch of git URL. So fetch is a kind of promise. So there are a lot more to discuss about the get request, post request, and promises and lot of things. But for now, due to the time constraints, I will keep it very simple. So this fetch functions, what does it do is it will hit the server. Call a get request with the URL mentioned. So and dot then after hitting the server, we will get a response, and we need to capture the response after we get the response. Hence dot then. So dot then specifies that after you get the response, you need to execute this function. So it's a synchronized manner. So dot then, we need to capture the data, right? So data, so this is again an arrow format, data dot json. So here is a small thing that you need to understand. The data that we get will be in the form of a raw data. If you see here, where is the API? Yeah. Okay, 1 minute. Okay, if you see here, the data that we get is in a raw format like a string, but we need to convert this data in a JSON format, and that's why we are using this string, this function called data.json. So it's basically we are converting the received data into JSON, and then what we need to do is we need to set some state. I mean, we need to capture the data and set within our component, like state. So we should maintain the data as a state in our component. And for that, we have a function called setState. Let me show how it is done. Response. This dot setState. And inside the setState, I will be mentioning what I need to set. So first, basically, I need to set the language. And that language is the lang string that I am getting through the function. The second one is the data. So I will just give result from git. And so the response that I am getting here should be captured here. And if you see, I don't want the whole response. I need only the items. So in the API, I don't need this whole thing. I need this item array alone so that I can go into and pass into it and get the appropriate values from that. So what am I going to do is I'm going to say response dot items. and I will have another state called is loaded as true. I will mention the reason. So we have this language result from Git and is loaded as set state here, but we didn't mention this here. So by default, we need this here. Language, I will give a blank value. So this is the initial value that is set to the state when the constructor is getting executed. So we have is loaded, we have language, and we have result from Git, which will be an array of objects. So this is how you mention that it will be an array of objects. And this is how you mention that it will be a string, and this is how you mention it will be a boolean value. And you have to initialize with a blank or empty value so that it gets initialized when the constructor is getting executed. So once this, I'm actually kind of going fast, but due to the time constraints, I have to. If at all you don't understand anything in the, you can just interrupt and ask me again. I am glad to explain it all over again. But this is something very important. So this is how we fetch the data or hit using a URL, get the data, convert it, and keep the data within our state. And let's see how. Okay, so how we will access this data in our components. So the third step is done. We need to write a function that calls the GitHub API and gets the results. That is done. Now the fourth thing is the calling the function when an option is changed in the dropdown. So what we need to do is, in the select component, when an event occurs, what event? On change. So on change is an event that that gets triggered when we change the options inside the select dropdown. So here, where is it? Where is my app? So here we are changing these options, right? So when we change the option, our event will be triggered, which is on change. So that is what I am going to override here. So on change is equal to opt this dot update language of opt dot value. I definitely understand that you won't get this right now. So what is happening here is, so basically any event when we call, it will return an event itself. Like when we call the on change, it will return an object called event object, and we need to capture the event object inside this opt and use that use the value inside that event. So if you have developed a plain JavaScript application, you would, I mean, it's a JavaScript based syntax. So in the JavaScript, whenever we trigger an event, a mouse event or a key press event, whenever you press an enter button, I mean enter key or up arrow key, there is an event that is get triggered, and that event will hold the value of what you have given. So that's what is getting captured here. When I change the option, an event is triggered along with the option that I selected. So this opt will have the value as Java when I select the option Java, and that is what is kind of passed into this function, and we are calling this function to fetch the data from the GitHub API. So let's save this, and what am I gonna do is, I'm gonna pass, okay, let me console here. So we got the response here. Let me console if we got the data or not. So the data will be stored in the state, right? So this dot state dot result from Git dot to string, because it's an object, and to make it readable, we need to put to string. or let me show without two string first, and I will show how it is, and then you will understand why I did this. So let me go here, and when I click Java, so in the console, you see an array. There's an array body content or JS41. I am not sure if it is visible for you guys. Let me. So I think now it's visible. So body content or JS in line number 41, it returns an array. So where is it? Yeah, line number 41. So this, and it's not in a readable format. So now I will put two string. Actually, I'm missing something. Let me tell what it is. You see, there is no data that is written here, and the reason is, as soon as I fetch this, there is some time lag before it gets fetched, and so immediately it is calling the console function, and you know, it is kind of doing it immediately before we get the response. So we need to set a variable, and that is why we have set this is loaded variable. So we need to show the components after the response is got and stored in the result from Git. So this is a typical thing that I need to repeat again, but I will repeat after implementing it. So what I will be doing is, before returning, I will check if this dot state dot is loaded is equal to true, or we just don't need to mention it, is obviously understandable. Else, okay, I'm doing the wrong way. One second. Inside the render, I need to return I will explain once again, just hold on a minute. So why we are doing this is, there is a time lag between sending the response, getting the data and showing it. So if we don't wait for the response to come, then we will end up showing the component before getting the response, and that's why we are having a blank value here. So we are kind of displaying it before we get the response. So what I am trying to do is, I am first checking whether we got the response or not. So by default, before getting the response, the isLoaded value will be false. So before getting the response, when it is false, the first thing will be the if part will be returned. If the response is loaded, I mean, if we got the response, then the else part will be loaded. How? So before, I will mention here, before getting response, is loaded is false. So not of, you can see there's a not option here. So not of false is true. So before getting the response, this will be returned. And after getting the response, this will be returned. And before getting the response, I don't want to show the value. So what am I gonna do is, I will tell that okay, 5 more minutes, we'll finish this. I will show how it is, how we are getting the response. Sorry for the delay. So in the paragraph, I am telling like it is, okay, let me have H2 here. this is still loading, and if it is so this is what I'm going to return before getting the response, and after getting the response I am going to display the result. This dot state dot result from get dot to string, and you can see that I have mentioned this in the JSX expression within the curly braces, which is important to remember, and we know this so see, this is before getting the response. Now I am selecting something. You see there is a lag. So you saw that, right? So there was there was a 2 seconds lag after selecting. So that is the 2 seconds where we are hitting the GitHub API and getting the response. And if you see you see there is a list of objects in getting showing a string, because that I haven't converted it properly. So what I need to do is I need to access a specific object and convert into string. So let us see how we can pass through it. So this is the items that we have inside this response. So this first object will be this one. Actually, I should be having a JSON view of this. I don't know why I am not getting it. Just give me a second. 5 more minutes and we will kind of wind up, I guess. Yeah, got it. So this is the JSON view, and this items is what we have in our this dot state dot result from git, and inside this thing we have a list of objects, and that is what the 30 objects that you can see on clicking it. So you see there are like 30 objects, but we need to get a specific value inside each object. So let us take this name value. So inside the response I should take the zeroth object and get the name value Java guide. So let us see how we can get this Java guide. So what am I going to do is this dot state dot result from git of 0, which points to the first object inside the list of object, dot name. Now I will save, and if you see the React tab, I am selecting this Java. See CS notes. So maybe when I select Java, it's returning the first object that I am having is CS notes. So let us see. So Java. Okay, this is giving a different response, but I think you get what I am trying to say. So to you need to pinpoint to the specific object and its value so that you get this. So till now we have what we have done is we have created a body component, we have a drop down, we know how to create a drop down, we know how to call a function, how to write a function where you can hit an API and get the response, and we know how to parse it and display it here. Now as we are running out of time, I will just show you or explain you already pre-built application that I showed you before, so that you will get to understand how this is getting filtered. So is it okay if I take 5 more minutes, or I need to wind up?
Okay, proceed, Lokesh.
Okay, thank you. I will finish it as soon as possible. So I'm just moving into the previously built application so that I can explain you by going through the code. I will also share the repository link to you in the chat after the session ends. You can go through all the repositories that I have developed and have a glimpse of it. I am sure that I would have added a lot of comments to make it understandable, maybe. Just see, and if you have any doubts, you can contact me later again. So this is it. When I click on Java, I am getting a list of things, right? So how this is achieved? This is achieved through a component called card group and cards component. Let me show you the code behind this. So form. So this is the exact function that we implemented, which is hitting the URL and setting the state. And these are the options that we have. We have Ruby, Java, CSS, Python, all. And this is the same set state that we did. Now, what we didn't do is we didn't have these show content component, where we are like showing the content by parsing it one by one. So inside the show content component, I have a list of a card template. So what am I doing is I have this card template component where I am passing the values as this.props.response of index. So this index will have 0 or 1 or 2. And when I pass 0, the whole object, that is Firefox. Yeah, this whole object is there, right? Inside the items of 0, this whole object is passed into this card template. And inside the card template, I have a card component where I will be able to pass through the thing. So props.list.owner.avatar.url, props.list.name. So I am passing the props, right? That of 0. So I am passing this whole thing. So inside this, if you see owner, and inside the owner, you have avatar URL. So that's what is having here, props.list.owner.avatar.url. So the URL that is given here, okay, that is that will be the value that is here. So obviously the image is somewhere in the online, and we are giving the value of the URL to the source attribute so that we can render that image for the card. And inside the body we have the title, where props.list.name. So props.list is what we got, and inside the zeroth object we have this name. Where is that name? Java guide. So this name will be passed here. And inside the text we have props.list.description. So we have this description. Where is the description? So this one, Java, Kashamusha, this in Chinese, which I don't know. So this is what is getting passed here. So what we are doing is we are writing this only once as a template, and we are kind of looping this. And we are kind of looping it by passing the index alone and getting through the data and showing it in a looped manner. So that is what is happening. And where is my app? So this is a spinner that I had. So this is a component from same React Bootstrap. So instead of telling, so we had, right, this is still loading. So instead of putting this text, we can put a spinner component to display this. And when we select a option, that will get replaced and this will be there. And all these hovering, this dark background, are all inbuilt objects. And you can see the description is given here. the name Java Guide appears here, and these are the stars, these are the folks, and we have the link and link here mentioned. If we click on that, it will get redirected to the GitHub repository of that page, so that you can have a look over it, clone it, and explore whatever you can. So I know I kind of rushed up, but I just want, my aim or objective of this session is to make you understand how easy it is to develop an application of this. This is a kind of, I have compressed a 5-hour effort into 1-hour thing, and we had power interruptions in the middle, so it kind of went so rushed up. Apologies for that. But if you have any doubts, or if you want a separate part that you need to get repeated, I can do it. If you would like to contribute your time, I can even proceed and bring the app to this stage, but that will take another 30 minutes. So I just don't want to make yourself stressful. You have already contributed like more than 1.5 hours of your continuous time, and thank you so much for that. If you want to know how this application works deeply, you can contact me offline anytime. And I guess we are open for questions now. I don't have any more slides. So let me see if we have any questions.
Participants, okay. Do you have any questions?
You can ask any part that needs to be repeated. I understand that I have kind of rushed in the middle. So please do mention in the chat or ask whichever part you didn't get so much. So yes, I guess we have some question. Yes.
Think participants are very silent. So we can take it in the positive side that they have understood whatever you have taught, Lokeshwar.
Sure, ma'am. I will get to know in that feedback form.
Yeah. Really, thank you, Lokeshwar, for sparing your time and teaching on React.js, for sharing your practical knowledge. Really, it was very informative because everything was shown online as a demo. So I hope students will remember what they have learned. It was a very useful session. For 2 days, you have shared your knowledge. Thank you. Thank you, participants, for your kind patience. If you have any doubts, you can clarify with them anytime. You can contact them, right?
Okay.
So note, I think.
Thank you, ma'am. I just have one question in the chat, so I'll just.
Explain.
Thank you so much, ma'am. So, so we have a question saying, can we have a basic web application development step-by-step tutorial with top bar, bottom slide menu? Yes, definitely. If you ready to spend time and observe, definitely we can have a session. Or I am kind of trying to develop videos regionally, like in Tamil, Telugu, and English, but that is kind of getting postponed like indefinitely due to the occupied work at my organization. So let me see if I can fulfill your wish through YouTube tutorials. Or let us see if we can arrange another session through FSFTN in another weekend, and see if we can acknowledge your requirement. Thank you, Nelson, for asking that in the chat. And one more thing I would like to mention is, don't stop after learning. Please share or collaborate and learn and try to reproduce it in a lot of forums that we have. And FSFTN is one such good forum that provides the platform to gain more and also contribute more. Yes, I guess we are all, more than 30 minutes delayed. Yes, ma'am. Over to you, ma'am. You can proceed and close the session. I will just ping my GitHub URL in the chat, and also my mail ID. You can mail, or you can mail me regarding any of your requirements. Let me just fetch my URL. So this is my URL, github.com/lokeshwartabjula, LOKESHWARTABJULA. And interesting repositories that you would like is Wally.json is an Android application that I developed, which will have basic GET requests and POST requests with a lot of JSON handling inside it. And we have Angular applications also, very basic application. And React. So you will find Angular, React, Android, and two static websites inside this repository. Have a go through and install and have fun exploring. Let me ping that. So this is the URL and my mail ID is this. Ma'am, do I have the liberty to share my contact number, or is it like not recommended?
It's up to you. If you are interested, you can share. No problem.
Yes, no problem. So this is my contact number, and you can reach out through WhatsApp or call, or even I'm available in Telegram with the same name. Yeah, you can contact anytime. I will be responding in weekends if I am not occupied. Yes, thank you so much. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you, Lokeshwar, for your support. For your juniors and everybody, thank you. We can close the session with us. Have a nice weekend.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye bye.